Taira. Pranams to Swami, dear brothers and sisters. Today we will take up Bhagwan's conversations with students in the veranda there in Prashanthi Nilayam in the month of May. So the text what I am going to speak to you belongs to the period May 2001. Incidentally, I may tell you, we completed 2002 and now we have come to 2001. I should thank you for your keen interest that you have been showing from time to time in trying to know what Swami said, and I appreciate the spirit of service with which you have been sharing this with all those that will come in contact with you regarding this. Bhagwan made a comment which is of immense value to all of us. What he said is this: if you act according to my words, if you follow my command, you will be free from all the troubles. You will be free from all the problems. And the second statement was, God is like a magnet. And that God, with magnetic attraction, draws everyone towards Him. And nothing wrong with the magnet. Magnet is perfect. And that perfect magnet attracts everyone. Well, here I want to explain Bhagwan's statements. In Ramayana, there is one very important character by name Hanuman. Hanuman followed scrupulously the command of Lord Rama, and therefore he attained that state as to receive adoration and worship from everybody. Following the command of God will make you eligible to receive worship from the community. The society will take you as an ideal, as the best example. Incidentally, I can also tell you, in Mahabharata, Pandavas followed Krishna strictly and therefore they are rewarded. They were victorious towards the end and highly acclaimed by everybody till this day. Here I want to share with you a simple anecdote mentioned by Bhagwan in his discourse. You must have heard of Krishna, the child Krishna, who was always in the habit of stealing curd and the milk from the neighbors. Those who have some idea of Mahabharata will understand. It's not a question of stealing. It has an inner significance altogether. But story part is this, that he goes to the neighbor houses and drinks milk, partakes butter without their notice. Butter is the human heart. The milk is devotion. The pot is the human body. That is the inner significance. Stealing meaning God capturing human heart in secret without your knowledge. That is the inner significance. Now, Krishna one day started drinking milk. How was he drinking milk? He kept two of his feet in the lower pot. and started drinking the milk from the upper part, just tilted upside down, turned the pot on the top upside down, started drinking while keeping both the feet in the lower pot containing milk. Mother went in search of him and ultimately found Krishna here. And Krishna immediately jumped and started running. Mother could not find him anywhere. Ultimately, she found footsteps of Krishna because they are full of milk. So, basing on that footsteps full of milk, mother could trace him out finally. This episode from Mahabhagavata tells us, if you follow the footsteps of God, you will reach him. Krishna, the God, his mother, the devotee, following the footsteps of Krishna, could catch him. Similarly, we the devotees should follow his footsteps to reach him. That is the anecdote mentioned by Bhagavan. There is also another thing. Some of us may feel that we are not drawn by Baba. That Baba has not drawn us close to him. We may feel like that. But we are wrong. Why? God is the magnet. We are the iron pieces. Nothing wrong with the magnet. The iron piece with full of dust, full of rust, will not be drawn by the magnet. So mistake lies with the iron and not with the magnet. So the iron must be pure, the iron must be clean in order to be attracted by the magnet. So God is the magnet. The devotee is the iron, should be free from the dust of attachment, from the rust of ego. When these two are not there, the iron is automatically attracted by the magnet. That's what Bhagavan has said. Watching the situation, quite convenient, mood of Bhagavan being quite welcoming, I dare to put a question. Bhagavan, why do we find obstacles in the spiritual path? Why obstacles, problems along the way of spiritual life? Why, Bhagavan? And Swami gave an answer straight. There are no obstacles in the spiritual path at all. It is your weakness. It is the lack of faith in you which is responsible for all the obstacles. Actually, spiritual path is straight without any obstacles. Bhagavan said there are two reasons for the obstacles along the spiritual way of life. What are they? One, lack of faith. The second, the consequences of the previous life. The reactions of the previous life, they are all responsible, which will not allow us to walk along the spiritual path. And then, Bhagavan said, this is a very important point for all of us. We think we are on the spiritual path, but strictly speaking, we are not. Why? Our goal is worldly. Our goal is mundane. Our goal is physical. Simple example. I want to pass in the examination. I go to the temple, break a coconut, make some offering to God. Is it devotion? No. My going to the temple is only to get a pass in the examination. The goal is worldly. The purpose is worldly gain, selfishness. But it cannot be called devotion in the true sense. So Baba made this statement, anything that you do out of selfishness and self-interest, anything you do is not at all spiritual. So the spiritual path requires unconditional love for God, not any worldly gain or worldly objective. Now, you find two classes of people in mythology. One, devas, angels. Second, rakshasas, demons. Devas, angels, they had devotion, which is totally spiritual and selfless. So they are worshipped. But while the demons also did penance for years and years, followed every spiritual path, but they are condemned because their motive is worldly. Their motive is born out of selfishness. They are totally egoistic, and therefore Bhagavan says, your devotion should be selfless. Further, Swami added another statement, which is quite encouraging to all of us. If you have strong faith, if you strengthen your faith, make it strong and stronger, you will be able to cross any number of obstacles on the way. Which is true with all of us. I don't think that we are here in a most comfortable way. I don't think so. We are able to cross all the problems. We are able to face all the obstacles because of our own strong faith in God. So where there is strong faith, you will never fear. You will be able to face any problems. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then, Bhagavan, excuse me for putting this question, how do I know that I reach very high state, very high level in spirituality? How do I know that I have gone to very higher and higher levels? Immediately came the reply, there are no levels in spirituality. Nothing is low, nothing is high. All are same in spirituality. That's what Bhagavan has said. And further he explained, there's caste system, there's class structure. Class structure, caste system, the haves, the have-nots, rich, poor. These are all the levels in the world. These are all the levels in the community. But in spiritual path, there are no levels, there are no heights, all are equal. Because God is one without the second. God is one without the second. So there is no question of one being higher than the other. That's what Bhagavan said. Swami, I know that I'm crossing my limits. But please excuse me. I have one doubt here. All of us know that you are God. But why are we not able to follow you? Why don't we follow you? We know that you are God. Why? These are all questions which requires some courage to ask. And is grace and mercy to have tolerated such questions. It's really risky. But anyhow, the question is, I repeat once again, because it applies to every one of us. We know Baba is God, but still why don't we follow Him? That is the question. These answers Baba said, look here, at home, mother cooks. Mother prepares all cookies, all sweet dishes, or delicious items. But the son wants to go to the hotel. He doesn't want to sit. He doesn't want to eat anything that is cooked at home by mother. He wants those things in the hotel, restaurant. That is the fate. Similarly, though God is here with all the love, you don't understand. You don't understand. That's what Bhagavan said. Further, he added another statement. Mother will not serve sweets to one son. And he serves all sweets to another son. The one son should not feel bad. She has not served him sweets because that son is diabetic. He should not eat sweets, so she doesn't serve. Similarly, God fulfills the desires of some people. He does not fulfill the desires of others. Why? It is good for them. He knows what is good for us best. Then, Baba said, some people are not able to follow me because their wishes are not fulfilled. Their desires are not fulfilled. And hence they are not able to follow me. That's what Bhagavan has said. Suddenly boys started raising their voice, pleading with Bhagavan in chorus. I was hearing what it is. All boys said, Swami, come to hostel. Swami, come to hostel. Everybody shouted. Swami said, all right, I'll come. Wait. And then he said, boys, I want all of you to live together as brothers. There should be unity among you. Live together, learn together, grow together in fraternity, in love, which is very, very important. And then Swami said, India achieved independence, but it has not achieved unity till today. There is no unity till today. So unity is most important. Then he gave example. Threads can be cut with the two fingers, but a cloth cannot be cut with the fingers. Why? All threads are woven into a cloth. When threads are woven into a cloth, the cloth is strong. You cannot cut it. When there are individual threads, easy to cut it. Similarly, when you stand united, nobody can defeat you. Nobody can attack you. Unity is very important. And further, Bhagavan said, there are three words that he used here. One is rakti. Rakti meaning fulfillment. Bhakti, devotion. Mukti, liberation. So when there is unity, it is fulfillment, rakti. Unity is bhakti, devotion. And unity leads to mukti, liberation. That's what Bhagavan said. Then, Bhagavan attended the hostel. He spent some time and he gave all the joy to students. And next day, he was speaking about the earthquake in the state of Gujarat in the year 2001. There was terrific loss of lives and property. Swami made a comment on the earthquake. Natural calamities. Why do they happen? Swami gave a beautiful answer for all the devotees to know. One thing he said was, If you are a slave to your senses, you are going to be a slave to the whole world. If you conquer your senses, everybody, the whole world, will become your slave. So be a master of your senses. Never allow yourself to be a slave to your senses. No, that's what Bhagavan has said. Swami said today, people have more of desires, building castles in the air, ashalu, ashalu. But people do not have ideals, ashayalu. Ashayalu are the ideals, ashalu are the desires. So people have desires, they don't have ideals. That's how the present day society. Then I wanted to ask Swami, what is the difference between asha, the desire, and ashaya, the idea? Then Swami explained this. Because if we don't take this opportunity and ask Him, we'll never get it again. I strongly believe opportunity lost now is lost forever. So we should grab every opportunity. So the question is, Swami, what is the difference between asha, the desire, and ashaya, the ideal? Bhagavan said, asha, desire, is individual. Ashaya, ideal, is fundamental. We have forgotten this fundamental ideal, but we keep with us the individual desires. Therefore, you spoil yourselves like this. And then Bhagavan started explaining about the need for the spirit of sacrifice. Sacrifice, tyaga, is very, very necessary. Bhagavan said, whatever you do for your name and fame, it is not sacrifice. No. Further, he said, if you go on giving to others, you will get more and more from God. Learn to give so that God will give you. That's what Bhagavan said. But if you don't give, if you amass, if you hide, if you keep it to yourself, nothing will grow. Nothing will grow. If you start distributing and sharing, everything will grow. That's what Bhagavan has said. And further, Swami said, having been born as a human being, lead your life in such a way as to be called that you are a good man. Live to be good. Live to get a good name in society. That's what Bhagavan has said. But today, how is our life? Many people say in front of you are good. Behind you, they will not have same feeling. So people should say you are good in front of you and also in your back. Meaning, you should be perfect in every possible way. And now Bhagavan started telling a simple story. Swami, is life so artificial? I asked. Is life so artificial? Swami said, yes. I see. So, can I be successful in leading an artificial life? Swami said, no. Because your artificial nature cannot continue throughout. One time or other, your natural quality will come out. One time or other. And here Bhagavan described a small story to explain that point. Any person, while in sad situation, in bad condition, he will come out of truth. The truth will come out of him. when he is under trial. When his life is at stake, the truth will come out of him. And Swami gave this story. It seems there was a great scholar who can speak excellently on Narayana and Lord Shiva. Excellently. You cannot say whether he is a devotee of Narayana or Shiva. Supposing if he speaks of Christ, if he speaks of Rama excellently, how can you decide whether he is a Christian or a Hindu? Impossible. Similarly, this scholar is speaking in a very high way about Narayana and Lord Shiva. People did not understand whose devotee he is. A lady was very clever. She brought an iron rod, kept it in the fire, heated it, and branded him on his back. Then that fellow shouted, "Abba, Narayana, Narayana, Narayana." So everybody could know he is a devotee of Narayana. So the truth will come out when the life is in danger, when you are in difficulty. That's what Swami said. And then Swami started inquiring about boys. He called warden to come close to him and said, "Warden, how are the boys?" "Swami, they are fine." "How about food?" "Very good, Swami." "Good. How are they? How is the food?" The warden said, "Swami, they eat well. Baga tintunaru, tintunaru. Eat well." Swami said, "Tintam kadu, not eating. Untam, life is important. Baga untunaru, they are well. Tell me that they are very good, rather telling me that they are eating nicely. I don't want it. I want a report from you. They are very good there." See, here there are two words. Tintam, meaning eating. Untam, living. So they should live well, not simply eat well. That's what he said. Oh, there were peals of laughter. Then, suddenly Swami started speaking in Italian language. Italian. Amere? Amere? Something like that. Well then, one word he used. Amore? Amore. Amore. Well, Swami said Italian, Italian. Oh. Then, I was looking at him, he said, "You know what, amore?" "I don't know, Swami." "It means you like it. You like it." "Oh, I say, Swami." Then I could understand there is no language that is not known to him. He knows all the languages. Well, we were very much surprised. And then he started making fun of one boy who does not know Telugu. He called that boy from Bihar. "Hello, boy, you know what is Kanti? Kanti? Kanti is a Telugu word." That boy does not know Telugu. Somebody is, Swami said, tell what? Somehow, he said, "Swami, Kanti is light." Correct answer. Oh. Then Swami said, "You know Kanta? Who is Kanta?" The fellow did not know. Then he said, "Swami, the giver of light is Kanta." Everybody laughed. Kanta means woman. Oh, everybody laughed. That's how Swami cuts joke and enjoys, makes everybody laugh. And then, warden said, "Swami, your love is infinite. Your love is infinite. Your love is so deep like an ocean. It is so vast." That's what warden said. "You know what, Baba? said in reply, "Yes, but I am ready to give you that infinite love, and there are none to receive it." There are none to receive the infinite love from my hands. What can I do? I am ready to give it. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then, Swami, one question, please. Come on. What is that question? Swami, today, when God is present in the form of avatar, incarnation, why are we not able to realize and work for liberation? Why? We are contemporary avatar. Yes, but yet, why are we not liberated? Why? Liberation is not given to everybody. Why? This answer Baba said. Many participate in running race, but only one fellow stands first in the running race. So you may be my contemporaries, but one may attain liberation. Not all, as in a running race. This what is said in Bhagavad Gita. Swami gave this example of running race. Bhagavad Gita said long ago, out of millions and millions and millions, billions of people, few people are interested in God. Out of those few people, very few people are interested in liberation. Out of very few people who are interested in liberation, only handful may attain liberation. Only handful may attain liberation. So similarly, while we are happy being the contemporaries of avatar, we should also know whether we are deserving liberation or not. And I should also give you one example given by Shirdi Sai. What did he say? Shirdi Sai said, a mango tree has so many flowers. Every flower will not develop into a fruit. So many flowers fall down. Only few flowers develop into fruits. Similarly, most of you people may come here, but only few attain liberation. That's what he said. So having said what happened in the month of May 2001, now I pass on to June 2001. Swami, this is the question. What is the difference between the mind and heart? Then Swami said, it is not the physical heart, it is the spiritual heart which is important. And the difference between the spiritual heart and the mind is this. Mind is wavering while the spiritual heart is steady. The physical heart is present on the left side. The spiritual heart is present throughout the body. And Bhagavan said, the spiritual heart should be is steady, while the human mind is wavering. It shakes. Then I said, Swami, I don't understand. Spiritual heart being steady, spiritual heart being on the right side, the physical heart being on the left side, I don't understand. Please. Then Swami said, values like truth, love, sacrifice, tolerance, forbearance, patience, they are all born in your heart. Intelligence, logic, sciences, humanities, all knowledge of the world, they are all contained in the head, in the mind. Then Swami, all right, but I pray with my mind. I am praying with my mind. What shall I do? I think you all follow me. Am I right? Bhagavan said heart is important. But we pray with our mind. What shall I do? Bhagavan gave this answer. Please note this. It is very important for all Sai devotees or devotees of any religion for that matter. Whatever you do with your mind is going to give you satisfaction which is temporary. Satisfaction is the result of all efforts that you do with your mind. But if you do it wholeheartedly, pray wholeheartedly with all your heart, you will be successful. It gives you permanent bliss, unlike the happiness and the satisfaction of the mind which are temporary. That's what Bhagavan has said. But still, my mind is not free from doubt. My mind is not able to receive what all Bhagavan is telling. Then I said, Swami, please permit me to put another question. We often say, he has a good mind and his is a bad mind. What is the difference between a good mind and a bad mind? See that. Bhagavan gave a beautiful answer. What he said was, mind is like water, which is steady, And on the surface of the water, you find waves, ripples on the surface of the water. They are your feelings. The feelings decide whether it's a good mind or a bad mind. If the feelings are bad, it is a bad mind. If the feelings are good, it is a good mind. To repeat once again, mind is the water, the ripples and the waves on the surface represent waves or the feelings. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then I thought, I am little intelligent. A feeling started in me that I know some philosophy. I wanted to exhibit it. Swami, I have one doubt. Yes, what is it? Swami, in deep sleep, where is the mind? In deep sleep, where is the mind? Baba said, mind is there in calmness. Mind is there in stillness. Mind is there equanimous. Mind is passive. Mind is silent in deep sleep state. Not that mind is absent. Not that mind runs away. No. It is passive. It is silent. It is in the neutral state. This interpretation I have not heard before. Very good. Swami, all right. Somehow I got my mind, whether it is artificial or natural, good mind or bad mind, whether it is passive in deep sleep or active in the waking state, somehow the mind is really making me a monkey of it. Now I have got one doubt. My mind is running everywhere. It is wavering. What shall I do? What shall I do? Baba said, let your mind run, But you do not run after your mind. Oh, I see. How? How? Baba said, child will go on playing everywhere, but will return to mother. Child will be playing here and there, but will come back to mother. Similarly, mind is the child. Let this the mind, the child play everywhere, go. It will come back to you. But if you also run after the mind, well, you are lost completely. That's what beautiful example Bhagwan said. And finally he said, mind is not independent. Please understand. Mind is not independent. Oh, I see, I don't know that. I think that I am controlled by my mind. No. Swami said, mind is not independent. You are the master of your mind. Mind is not your master. You are the master of your mind. That's what Bhagavan has said. And finally he said, mind is only an instrument, while you are the master. It depends on you how to control your mind. And Bhagavan said, the same mind can be used to attain liberation, and the same mind can take you to bondage. Swami, same mind takes me? Yes. How? Baba said, if you turn the key towards the left side, the lock closes. If you turn the key towards the right side, it opens. Same key. Turning difference. Similarly, if the mind is turned towards the word, it is bondage, locked. If the key is turned towards God, the mind towards God, the lock opens. That is liberation. So the same key, difference in the turning. So, is it world side or God side? Same thing. Swami, what a wonderful example. Now I understand. Swami, it's all right. You tell me that I should not follow the mind, that mind should follow me. Then who am I? You follow me? Then Baba said, above the mind, there is buddhi or intellect. Above the mind, there is buddhi or intellect. Intellect is the decision-making part in the human personality. Intellect judges. Intellect decides. Therefore, intellect is powerful to discriminate. So what should you do now? Let the intellect decide. What is decided by the intellect may be thought by the mind. Whatever that is thought over by the mind be enacted by the senses. Am I clear? Whatever father says, mother should understand. Whatever mother conveys, children should follow. Am I clear? Father is intellect, mother is the mind, children are the senses. I am speaking of an ideal family. I am not speaking of the modern family. I am sorry, because mother will say thank you to father, and father will never say to the mother, and children are not there in the house. They are busy outside. But I am speaking of a traditional good family, where children obey the mother, where mother obeys the father, a typical family. Similarly, the intellect should decide, having discriminated, and the mind should take instructions from the intellect, and the mind should think and pass on to the senses to act. That's what Bhagavan has said. All right, Swami, sometimes I am at a loss to know what to do, what not to do. To be or not to be, that is the question. Most of the times I am fine. Sometimes, shall I do this or not? What shall I do? I am in utter confusion. What shall I do then? It is at that time, Baba said, this confusion is because when the mind does not act according to the intellect, there is conflict. If the mind follows intellect, there is no conflict. There is total agreement. There is total agreement when intellect follows the mind. Because whatever intellect says is final. Whatever intellect decides is in your own interest. But the mind will not follow. Because mind has got its own vagaries, its own whims and fancies. So when the mind and intellect disagree, there is conflict, there is confusion. That's what Bhagavan said that day. While he was speaking like this, a man, hefty personality, four of us should join. And I don't think we will be equal to his size. And Swami turned his head and noticed him coming. He was walking there in the veranda trying to take his seat. Swami looked. See that. See him. How is he? His stomach is like a question mark. See that. You should not have overweight. You should not have obesity, extra weight. Because if you have got so much of weight, it leads to heart complaint. Heart is affected. So you should control your body. And then Bhagavan said, while walking, you should not be gasping for breath. Like that. While walking, if you start gasping, it means heart trouble is starting. So, Swami said, be careful with your food habits. Hurry, worry, curry. Hurry, we're in constant hurry. Worry, constant worry. Curry, the oily stuff that we eat in the canteen. They are responsible for heart complaints. That's what Bhagavan said. Swami, please pardon me. Please be sympathetic towards me. I have one doubt, Bhagavan. What's your doubt? You say that I should not worry. But how not to be worried? How? We are all married people. We have children and wives. She is the source of worry to me, I am the source of worry to her. And children are the source of worry to both of us. We are the source of worry to them. So everyone is a worry to the other nearest person. So how can we be free from worry? The married people. For sannyasis, bachelors, we envy them. Very good. They are very comfortable. They are comfortable. We envy them. It's too late to copy them. But a householder, how to be worryless? Then Baba said, worry is not the solution to your problems. No. If worry solves your problems, come on. Worry and worry and worry. Worry is not the solution. So Swami, what shall I do? Always remember, what is bound to happen will happen. What is not destined to happen will not happen. Things happen in their own way. You don't get worried about it. You just leave it. Oh, I see. I kept quiet because if I further question Swami, I may get worried later. When he's speaking, don't worry, why should I be worried now on this question of not to worry? Swami, is it possible practically not to worry? Is it possible? He said, yes, definitely. How, Swami? Look at me. I got so many projects. I got so many responsibilities. I am never worried. Then I said, Swami, you are not worried because you are God. I said, more musko, shut up, he said. I liked it. And Swami left that place. And then finally he turned back. Today, I spoke for a long time. You see? And all those people sitting there are not able to hear me. Arre, what a pity it is. That's what Swami said. Shall I say yes? If I say yes, he may not come tomorrow. If I say no, I cannot say because it is true. All devotees are not able to hear him. So what shall I say? Then I said, Swami, all the devotees are happy that they are having prolonged period of darshan. They are very happy. They may not be able to hear you, but they see you for a long time from a distance. Very good. If they are happy, good. And then, next day, there was some kind of discussion on pleasure and pain. Pain and pleasure. There's some kind of discussion. Then, he was telling what pleasure is, what pain is. I said, Swami, I want pleasure. I don't want any pain. What shall I do? Simple question. You want pain, do you? No. Nobody wants pain. Everyone wants pleasure. Swami, what shall I do? He said, it is impossible. No. Your feet and the head belong to the same body. You cannot say, I want to have head only, I don't want to have the feet. You cannot say, I want only feet but not the head. Both are necessary. Head is the pleasure. Feet represent the pain. Are the same body of life. They go together. There cannot be pain without pleasure. There cannot be pleasure without a pain. And Swami said, pleasure is an interval between two pains. Pleasure is an interval between two pains. You cannot avoid it. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then, Swami, since I see you in physical form, I don't expect any pain because I'm seeing you here. I expect only pleasure because I see you. Then Baba laughed and said, in the temple, do you ask God there? You go to church. You go to your church. Do you ask Christ, oh Christ, why am I suffering? Do you ask Him there? You go to temples. Rama temple, Krishna temple. Do you ask Rama, why pain, why not pain? Do you ask Him? Because you see God in a human form today, talking to you in front of you, you doubt. Whereas if God is in the form of idol, you never doubt. Therefore, understand one thing. Whatever that happens in your life is for your own good. Then there is no question of pleasure or pain. Even pain turns into a pleasure. If I understand whatever that happens to me for my own good, I'll be try to reconcile with the situation. That's what I said. And then Swami said, what did happen? What happened this morning in the college? What was the program in the college? Then I said, Swami, one speaker from America spoke on values and management. Swami was happy about it. And then he asked, what are values? We heard the lecture for 1 hour, but we could not give the answer to his question, what are the values? Finish. Then Bhagavan said, values are of two types. The values that change from time to time, depending on the circumstances, the civilization, the social order, norms of the society, they are individual values. But the values that do not change, like truth, peace, love, they are fundamental values. So values are of two types. Values which are individual and values which are fundamental. And then I said, Bhagavan, I have one doubt. We know the temples are managed by trustees. Every temple is managed by trustees. Trustees, what we call devasthana. Devasthanam, meaning trustees. Swami made a pun of the word. This is not devasthanam. This is nasthanam, my place. Nasthanam, my place, is not devasthanam. Clearly, we should know that. Temple does not mean the property it holds and the land property it has got around. No. Temple means the place where God is. So when Swami says, it is not devasthana, it is not mere temple, nasthana, it is my place, it makes all the difference. Let us pray in that temple where we'll have the feeling of the divinity. Then that happened to be the Sunday. Usually Swami talks to boys in the evening time. I don't know, he wanted to speak in the morning time before bhajan. After interviews he came out and around 8:30 or 8:15, and bhajan starts at 9 o'clock. Still left with fortnight, 45 minutes. So he wanted to speak on that. So he took the advantage of 45 minutes left and started speaking to us. There is one great poet by name Potana. Three letters. Potana. Potana. He has written Bhagavatam. Swami was speaking about him. See, what a great poet Baba is. Po means go. Tana means the self. So, the very name Potana means, let all bad in me, Po, get out. So that Tana, the self, will remain in me. You understand this? So, let all that Po, get out. Tana, the self, remain. So, that is the meaning of Potana. That's what Bhagavan he said. Arere. What a wonderful interpretation it is. And Potana, such a great poet, led a very poor life. His was life of poverty, beggarly life. He didn't have enough of money. But a great devotee, very great devotee. And his own brother-in-law was also a great poet, a very rich man. See that. His brother-in-law also was a great poet by name Srinadha. Srinadha, a great poet, rich man. But his brother-in-law Potana, a devotee and a poet, but a very poor man. Then I said, Swami, what is this paradox? One is rich, other is poor, both are poets. What is this? Then Baba said, that man is rich from the point of heart, from the point of the wealth. But this man is rich from the point of devotion. That man, so-called rich from the point of the world and money, is poor in devotion. And Potana is poor in respect of property. So both are rich and poor. See that? Potana is rich in devotion, poor in wealth. While Srinatha is rich in wealth and poor in devotion. Oh, Swami, you alone can say that. We cannot understand. Then I said, Swami, Potana, people say, is a yogi, a man of spiritual realization. My doubt is, can a realized soul be a poet? I think you follow my question. Can a realized soul be a poet? Because in realization, he does not remain. In realization, he is one with God. Where is the question of composition, poetry? Then Bhagavan said, no. With this realization, one can do anything with the total awareness. Because Potana is a realized soul, his composition is full of devotion. That's what Bhagavan has said. And this is what is called yoga. Yoga is perfection. Yoga takes you to perfection. So Potana is a yogi. Because he attained the state of perfection in the field of literature. That's what Bhagavan has said. So one will be expert with yoga or with spiritual awareness. Then I wanted to get some more information. Swami, are there any more people of this type, or is the only example? He said there are many people. Who are they? Annamacharya, Tulasidas, Tyagaraj, all these people are yogis, realized souls, and they are singers. They are men of fine arts. Why not? That's what Bhagavan Swami said. Then one gentleman asked, Swami, how to experience bliss? How to experience bliss? Very good question. Swami said, with the senses you cannot experience bliss. With your mind, impossible to experience bliss. Bliss is not an experience. Bliss is the experiencer. Please be attentive to this. Bliss is the experiencer. And bliss is not an experience. Oho. Swami, who is experiencer and what is experience? He said, you are there now in waking state, you are there in a dreaming state, you are there in a deep sleep, you are there. And that real you is bliss. Not simply waking state or dreaming state or a deep sleep state. So Bhagavan said, the experiencer, the real you, in all the three states of consciousness, the waking, the dream and the deep sleep, that real I, the spirit, the Atma, is bliss and not the experience. Wonderful, Swami. Wonderful. Now I understand. Alright, in what form it is? Somehow or other I want to center the problem and get the answer. I don't want to say thank you and go. No. Let me pinpoint. Let me get the direct answer. Because he was so kind to answer. Everything was so quite favorable. Why can't we get the best out of it? Then I said, Swami, in what form is it? Then he said, in a gross form, in a gross body, bliss is in a subtle form. Oho. In a subtle body, bliss is in a gross form. Oho. Further confusion. Further confusion. In a gross body, bliss is in a subtle form. In a subtle body, bliss is in a gross form. Swami, I don't understand. Excuse me. How can it be gross here, subtle there? I don't understand. Then Swami said, here is a mango seed. When you sow that mango seed, it grows into a mango tree. Right? So where is the mango tree? Tree is in the seed. So seed is subtle and the tree is the gross present within the subtle. Within the subtle seed, which is subtle form, subtle body, there is a gross tree inside. Am I clear? Because it is only the tree of the seed that comes out. Am I clear? Oh, I see. And the big mango tree will have fruits inside which there are seeds. So, grass tree has subtle seeds. Subtle seed has grass tree. Therefore, bliss is present in a subtle form in a grass body. While it is present in a grass form in a subtle body. Now I seem to understand, Swami. It is getting into my head now. Now I understand. Then I said, out of gratitude, Bhagavan, who will tell us all these things? Is it okay? Who will tell us all these things? Then Baba said, who want these things? Everyone wants their favors, worldly progress, money, position, family. I am ready to tell these things, but who wants these things? No one. No one. Therefore, don't say, who will tell these things? I am here to tell you. But who are ready to hear me? Because they have got their own desires, their own problems. That's what. Since there are none who want these things, there are none who can understand these things, I am not telling these things. In fact, I want to speak on these subjects. That's what Bhagavan said. And then, Shivaratri festival was over that in that year, and it was the after Shivaratri festival, Swami made some statements. Very interesting. During Shivaratri, he asked one boy to speak before his divine discourse. That boy, while talking, he said, Swami, we don't want to see Lingam today because you struggle a lot to bring out the Lingam. We can't see you suffering like that. Swami, don't take pain upon yourself. We don't want. But still, Swami materialized Lingam for all of us. Swami called that boy. Hey boy, come here. What did you say yesterday? Swami, I only said, don't struggle. Don't undergo any pain. No Shivalingam today, Swami, we don't want it. Because we can't see you suffering like that. Then Baba said, no, no, no. To make you happy, I am ready to suffer. I am ready to suffer. To make you happy, to give you sense of satisfaction does not matter, whatever that happens to me. Then he looked at me and said, yesterday that boy said, don't materialize Lingam Swami, we can't see you suffer like that. Now tell me whether he won or lost, whether he succeeded or failed. Because he wanted Swami not to materialize Sivalingam, but Swami materialized. So is this boy successful or failed? Then I said, Swami, I think in explaining his heart, his feelings towards you, suffering so much for the emergence of Sivalingam, he succeeded. But you did not hear him, you materialized, he failed. So he succeeded and he also failed. Because we also learn from divine art now and then. Spending all the time, we also learn, you know. Then Baba said, no, no. He won on both the grounds. Because he is final. He won't accept anybody's. His is the ultimate. No, no, no. Why do you say that he succeeded and failed? No. He succeeded on both the grounds. How, Swami? Bhagwan said, in making a prayer out of his heart, he succeeded. Very good. Number two, had I not materialized Lingam, listening to his prayer, all these people would have blamed him. Because that fellow said, we don't want Lingam, Swami didn't do that. And they'll speak ill of him. They will blame him. Now, people have not blamed him. In that way also he succeeded. He is free from the public blame. In that way he succeeded. In offering my prayer to me wholeheartedly, he succeeded. So, he was successful on both the grounds. And now he said, Naku noppulu levu. Noppi means pain. I have no pain whatsoever. Anni oppule. Oppu means correct. Everything is perfect. No noppi, no pain. All oppule, all are correct. Whatever I do are correct. That's what he made pun on the Telugu word. Then I said, Swami, I want to thank you for one thing. He said, what is it? When you sit and materialize Lingam, all will not be able to see. I was praying within, Bhagavan, why don't you keep some TV sets so that all can see the emergence of Sivalingam? I was praying, Swami. But you were so kind enough. Without arranging TV sets, you got up and Sivalingam emerged out of your mouth. All could see. Very kind of you, Swami, because out of huge crowd, it will not be possible for everybody to see. You got up out of compassion, so that everybody will be very, very happy. Then Swami said, I will not be carried away by your praises. No. I will not be affected by your praise or blame. I do it for my happiness. I do it for my bliss. What is that bliss? The bliss of all my devotees makes me blissful. That's all. Not for your praises, what he said. Then I said, Swami, during Sivaratri this year, in the course of your discourse, you made a mention of Maya, illusion. What should I do to get out of Maya? What should I do? Then he said, you don't do. You don't have to do anything. It is enough if you know what Maya, what illusion is. it will go. If I know it will go,
yes.
I don't have to do anything?
Yes.
What do you say then? Swami, please, I don't understand. Then he gave one example. You are walking, this is a common example that he gives every time. In the evening time while you are walking, you see a snake on the road. And suddenly you are afraid of it. You put a torch and you will know that it is not a snake, but it is only a rope. But only a rope. You have mistaken it to be a snake. Then once you know that it is not a snake, that is only a rope, you are free from fear. You are free from fear. Similarly, when once you know it is Maya, it will get out. Just as fear will get out by knowing the truth, by knowing the fact that it is only a rope but not a snake. Similarly, when once you know it is Maya, it is illusion, it will leave by the very awareness of it. Now he gave some examples. Sometimes above 40 or above 50, because nowadays youngsters also are getting it. People will have cataract problem, cataract, eye problem, right? Cataract, you know that? Some layer will be formed on the eye. You will not be able to see clearly. This layer that has covered the eye has come out of the eye only. Not anything from outside. No layer from my neighbor's house has gone into my eye. It is only from my eye, a layer is formed covering my eyeball. Similarly, there is water which is not used. It is covered by moss. Moss is formed by the water. And the very moss covers the water. Am I clear? Here is fire. Out of the fire arises ash. And ash covers the fire. The sun is the cause for the cloud. And the cloud covers the sun. Similarly, the Maya arises in you only. Nobody has put you in Maya. It has arisen in you. So you have to take it out of you. It is your duty to come out of Maya because it is within you. Nobody, it has not come from outside. Am I clear, please? That's the example that Bhagwan has said. So what shall I do now, Swami? It has come from within me, all right. What shall I do? Then he said, here is fire covered by the ash. What should you do? Blow it up. Fire will, the ash will go and you can see the fire. Here is water covered by moss. What should you do? Remove the moss. You will see the water. Sun is covered by clouds. What should you do? Wait. Wind will take away all the cloud. Then sun will certainly spread his light. You will see the sunlight. So, blowing or removing the mass or the wind removing the cloud, they are all comparable to awareness or knowledge of the self. If you have the knowledge of the self, the reality, who I am, the covering of illusion or Maya will go on its own. A beautiful thing. This is what is called the awareness, the knowledge of the self, which Bhagwan can only explain, nobody can explain, in such a simple way. But being a weak man, still there is some doubt in the corner of my head. Swami, ah yes, what? Maya has gone. Is there any danger of Maya coming back to me? Illusion has gone. Will it come back or will it, has it left permanently? That is my question. Baba said, he laughed and said, remember this. One, if it comes, will never go. Another, if it goes, will never come back. The third, which neither comes nor goes. Oho. Three things. I have put one question. Swami has produced three answers. What are they, Swami? One, if it comes, will never go. That is knowledge or awareness. One, if it goes, will never come back. That is ignorance. The one which neither goes nor comes is your true self, the Atma or the Spirit or consciousness. Alright. I want to take it, make the discussion little lighter. Swami, what is Rahu Kala? Rahu Kala. You must be hearing devotees saying 3 to 4:30 Rahu Kala, 5 to 6 Rahu Kala. Even today I have not understood anything about it. And I have no faith in it. Let me be very honest about it. But when Baba says and when devotees are saying, for courtesy and for decency, I keep my mouth shut. But I have no knowledge of Rahu Kala. Somehow, I have put that question to make the discussion little lighter. Because it was very heavy till now. So, Swami, what is Rahu Kala? Though personally, I have no faith in it. Somehow. Then Swami said, Rahu Kalam is a movement around the equator. As the earth revolves, it's around itself, as the earth planet revolves around the sun, it is the movement of the sun between the equator, the movement of the sun. And as the sun moves, as the earth revolves, as we find the position of the earth planet, little above or below, along the equator, passing through the equator line, that is called Rahu Kala. Oho. Swami, what does it do with me? When the planet is rotating like that, when the position of the sun is like that, what am I to do it? Then he said, during that period, there will be some poisonous element in the sun rays. One has got to be careful. All those things that you do during that time will not be fruitful and successful. Therefore, Rahu Kala is very much observed. That's what Bhagavan has said. Alright. But I did not proceed further. Because I am not very much interested in the topic. One. Number two, I did not question further because I have to exhibit my ignorance on the topic. I don't want to take the risk. So, I just kept quiet with folded hands. Then, one very big politician, a very big minister, came to Swami on that day here. And he said, Swami, you are unique. Let all the colleges and universities in this country be managed by you. It is the prayer of all ministers. It is the prayer of everybody. You run the hospitals. You run the universities. It will be excellent. Baba is Baba. What a reply he said. My administration has got nothing to do with politics. You people come and go. You people change your parties. But I don't come and go. I don't change. I am the only one without the second. I continue to do that all. I always keep politics away from me. I don't want politics anywhere around. You politics can twist your tongue. Today you say yes, tomorrow you say no. I am not of that type. Whatever I say, it is only one. I'll hold on to it, I'll stick on to it, I'll implement it. That's what Bhagavan has said. And then, all right, with this harsh note, serious note, we should not conclude the evening session. So, I want to say a nice goodbye to that evening session. Swami, the lingam that you materialized is golden lingam and all that gold. That gold linga came out of your body. Is that gold? I said. He said, yes, definitely. Oh, I see. Go. Then Bhagavan said, all metals are in your body. All metals are there in every human body, including gold. And this gold in the body, because of severe heat, it got into a particular mold. And as it takes a definite mold, a form, heat is generated. Because of the heat only, it takes a definite form. And this linga comes out of the terrific force. That's why you must have noted that day. Linga came, thak, the terrific force, and fell on the ground. You must have noticed. So, because of the heat generated, it takes a mold, a shape of linga, and gets released out with a sudden force. That's what Bhagavan has said. That is what you mean. Hiranya Garbha Linga. Oh, Swami, this is there in you also. I could bring out why you could not. That's what Swami said. And on the next day, a short note, Bhagavan started telling his olden days, his visits to Madras and Delhi. He was mentioning all the names of the streets in Madras. All the names of all the localities in Madras. Then they, Swami, you know all the names of all the localities in Madras? I started visiting Madras right from the age of 11. At the age of 11, only I went to Madras. I know every corner of Madras. That's what he was telling. And then he was mentioning names of number of ministers, great people, union minister, state ministers, artists, maharajas, zamindars, who all visited him. And Bhagavan had been to Madras. All judges, Swami went on narrating those big people who visited him. Then Swami said, look here, people are attracted to this place. Just as honeybees come here to the lotus flower to suck the honey, people all visited this place. Then Swami made one statement with which I close the session for this evening. Please follow this very important statement. Many people visited this place and requested me to shift to cities, because Puttaparthi is a small village. In those days, there were no approach roads, no buses. People will have to travel by bullock cart. You know that? They found it very difficult to reach this place. So people from cities prayed to Swami, Swami, please shift to Bangalore, where we have trains and buses and flight, why don't you shift? But Baba said, no. The tree has to grow at the same place where the seed is sown, where it is planted. The tree has to grow where it is born, not elsewhere. That was the reply Swami has given that day. And today we understand the significance of this place. A tiny village has grown into a stature of a global village, attracting people from all countries, giving peace, solace and bliss to everybody coming from all over the world. That is the divine master plan of Bhagavan Sri Satya Sai Baba. Jai Bolo Bhagavan Sri Satya Sai Baba Ji Ki. Loka samasta sukhino bhavantu.